outdoor pigs at peace with the world. But as the suppliers of specialist breeding stock turn their attention to this kind of enterprise, we ask if their optimism is justified. Later in the programme, we have a report on the surge of interest in outdoor pigs. And as farmers' borrowings rise, I shall be talking to ex-ministry man turned banker Paul Ingram, now head of agriculture at Barclays. But first, the EEC's farm price package agreed last week in Luxembourg. One of the main planks of the deal for the UK was the devaluation of the green pound. There'll be different rates of devaluation for different commodities, with arable crops coming off best at almost 4%. But let's consider an example of what it means. The new buying-in price for feed grain in November, intervention won't start until then this year, will be £109.94 per tonne. But there are several deductions to take off that, like the co-responsibility levy of 6%, which comes to £6.59. And if you're relying on sale to intervention, you'll have to store the stuff until November, so allow £1 per month for that, a further £3. Then there's transport to the store, which will probably cost you up to £4 per tonne. And having delivered your grain, you'll have to wait at least 3 months for your money. Add that to the 3 months you've stored it, and that's 6 months of interest at, say, £7 per tonne, which adds up to a total deduction of £20.59 and brings your ex-farm price, discounted back to September, to less than £90 per tonne. And the prices of most other commodities are equally unimpressive. Well, Paul, how do you and the other banks react to these prices?
Well, we have two items of good news. The first is that we've got an early price fixing, and that's a help. The second is that we have got a green pound devaluation worth £155 million. But the bad news is that if you have to rely on £90 a tonne for cereals and can't get a better price in the market, then you're going to have hard times.
But overall, was it a wee bit better than you'd feared?
It could have been nothing. I think we can be quite pleased.
Well, good. We'll talk about the details later on in the programme. And with interest rates at an effective 15% or more, the cost of money is clearly crucial. And the amount the farming industry is borrowing is still rising. Over the last 10 years, it's gone up from less than £2.25 billion to an anticipated £6.45 billion this year. Meanwhile, the trend of farm incomes has been relatively static, except for the freak year of 1984, which in real terms, after inflation, means they've fallen dramatically. In the 5 years from 1979, 25% of national farm income went to pay interest charges. In the last 5 years, that's risen to 33%, and some forecasts suggest it may exceed 40% this year. Paul, before we actually talk about the details, do those figures include the amount that the Agricultural Mortgage Corporation is lending?
No, they do not. Those are bank figures. The Agricultural Mortgage Corporation lends about £700 million, so you have to add about 10% to the bank lending.
So overall, farmers owe over £7 billion,
that's right.
Now, that sounds an awful lot. Does it worry you as a banker?
Not taken on its own. The real problem is not the level of borrowing. The real problem is low incomes in some sectors and the way that borrowing is distributed.
Isn't it also a real problem, the fact that the amount of money goes up and up and up with each year?
Oh, indeed. We're in a time of relatively high interest rates, and our expectation is that the Chancellor won't be able to reduce interest rates much, if at all, this year. Now, if you have to add interest to borrowings, then, of course, they accumulate.
Are you restricting your lending to farmers at all, say, compared to what you were 2 or 3 years ago?
No, we're not. In our case, our lendings have gone up quite quickly over the last 2 years by about 10 or 11%. A bit faster than the average for all banks.
But surely your bosses are saying to you, keep calm everything down, lend less money and be more careful, aren't they?
They don't say it quite like that. They are inclined to tell us to be careful, and of course my job as agricultural manager in the bank is to tell the bank to be careful. We do have difficulties in some areas.
What proportion of your customers give you sleepless nights?
Very few, and I can say that quite truthfully. Of course, we're going to have some farmers who this year will exhaust their cash, their credit, and their security. Now, some of those people will have to go out of the industry, but that has always happened. It's not a new thing.
And yet you're still advertising for more business, aren't you?
Yes, we do advertise, but we advertise the kind of relationship that we like to have with our customers. And if people want to talk to us about banking, we are prepared to do it with them.
Which sector of agriculture appears to be under the tightest pressure, in the worst shape?
You don't have to go any further than the recently published ministry figures. It is the arable sector, and in particular cereal producers.
So here in East Anglia, that's where your sleepless nights are coming from?
It is in East Anglia that we have, that the industry has most of its problems.
So what are you doing about it? What are you telling your managers in East Anglia to do different to what they might have been doing a few years back?
Nothing very much, because we, of course, keep close to our customers and we know how those businesses are doing. What I would like to say is that if any farmer does feel that the cash is going to run out this year, the first thing to do is find out what the figures are, have a word with the accountant, and then speak to the bank manager before the bank manager has to speak to you.
And what's the bank manager's reaction going to be if I come along and say things are looking terribly bad? Is he going to say to me, sell up now while you've still got a bit, or will he say, we'll lend you more?
He's going to say, what is the way forward for your business and how can we help?
And are there any general guidelines you could give him, or does it always depend on individual circumstances?
It is always an individual matter, and that's not because I want to preach confidentiality, but the average figures hide a great deal of variation. We had cereal farmers who in 1988 made quite reasonable profits. We know that on average cereal farmers lost money and some lost a good deal of money. So you have to look at the individual case.
Now, earlier on this year at the Oxford Farming Conference, the Minister of Agriculture laid great stress on the fact that there was an awful lot of non-agricultural money coming into farming. Mm. Do you think he's right?
I'm sure he's right. Now, again, the Ministry have just published new figures of an income survey on small farms. And on those farms, income from outside agriculture far exceeds that that's earned on the farm. And the Minister was making the point that when he and the Commission are talking, the Council of Ministers are talking about setting prices to maintain farm incomes, they have to take some account of income that comes from off the farm.
In a word, is it going to get worse or will it now start getting better? Very briefly.
I've no doubt that times are going to be tight. One can't see a general move upwards in prices.
Good. Thank you very much, Paul Ingram. And now, pigs. Some of the most strident publicity at this week's pig fair concerned outdoor pigs. Practically every specialist breeding company was claiming that its new hardy hybrid gilts were the best for UK conditions and tried to pull in the punters. So why this sudden interest in outdoor pig production, and how relevant is it to East Anglia? David Richardson has been investigating.
Scenes like this have been commonplace on the downs of Oxfordshire for 50 years, but East Anglian farmers have in the main kept their pigs inside, partly because most of the land was heavier and therefore less suitable, and partly because pigs that could withstand outdoor conditions produced poorer quality carcasses. But times are changing, it seems. The new strains of outdoor sows are claimed to be capable of performing as well as their indoor cousins, as Ian Campbell of United Pig Breeders explained.
The programme which we started on this, on the outdoor programme, was one which had its beginnings in the factory and on the consumer's plate, in that we were looking for something which was going to be satisfactory. Well, not only satisfactory, but actually was positive in terms of meat eating. And if we started from that end and then managed to put together an animal which functioned outside with the same level of prolificacy and produced a slaughter animal which was able to grow and convert its food as efficiently as the standard large white landrace breeds, then we were going to be successful. Mm.
But why do you suppose that there has been so much publicity, so much apparent popularity of the outdoor pig in the last, literally, the last few months?
It's a combination of reasons, really. Partially because the farming scene is changing in terms of profitability of arable farms. Particularly in this East Anglia region where we have a lot of light land, which unless it's irrigated is difficult to find crops which are going to be profitable on. But probably even more so, it's due with the concept of a product which is wholesome and nutritious. And I believe very strongly in this, that we haven't begun to sell anywhere near as much pig meat in this country as we ought to. And some of that is related to the fact that the pig still has this image, pork still has the image of being something like it's a dirty product, it's not wholesome and nutritious. And I think that the outdoor scene partially captures that essence of wholesomeness.
One of the keys to the expansion of outdoor pig keeping in this country is the Duroc. All the companies which produce breeding stock for use outside now reckon that they're putting 25 to perhaps 50% of Duroc blood into those breeding gilts. Now, being a hardy breed, they've been used out of doors for many years in America where they come from. But most of the Durocs in this country now have come here via Denmark, where they've been selected for growth rate and carcass quality, and it's reckoned that they are now competitive in both of those characteristics with the white European breeds. Even so, the depth of the depression of 1988, when very few UK pig farmers made any margin at all, points up the necessity to consider the economics of a system first. So, is outdoor production profitable?
Yes, it can be. It involves a number of factors, of course. It involves the genetics, it involves the feed, it involves the stockman, it involves the land, it involves the cooperation of the arable farmer. Stockman, if I came back to as probably the key to it all, yes, if you have the right people, and the right people love this job, but if you have the right people, yes, you can earn money. And the unit where we're standing at the moment would have turned in a profit in 1988 when there were very, very few other pig units which actually managed to turn in anything other than a thumping great loss.
The man in charge of that herd, which showed a profit in 1988, was Jonathan Cushney. I went to see him on a cold but dry day.
Well, looks a nice, pleasant job to be doing on a day like this, Jonathan, but what about when it's raining and when you've got mud here instead of dust?
When that's muddy, David, I try and feed them on the grass.
Because if this is a conventional unit, you'd have your sows inside in individual feeders to try and stop them fighting. Do you get any troubles with that here?
We have some fighting. You've probably seen behind you there's a sow with her vulva bitten. But that was mainly because I put her in yesterday when we weren't feeding, and they've been perhaps chasing each other around a bit. But while they're feeding, if you draw the food out in a very long row, as you can see, then there's enough room for everyone to
feed. They all get a chance.
And they get out of the way, you see, if no sow will fight sort of too severely, because they can run away here, there's plenty of room.
What about when it comes to service, though? I mean, you're putting a bunch of sows together and you put a boar in with them as well. Are there any problems there?
Not many. The problems come when the boars are older, if you mix boars when they're over about a year and a half. But
you do actually mix boars in a situation like this?
Yes, I have had to, because it's important to keep a large group of at least five boars. For when we wean 10 sows together.
Yes.
And if you don't have enough boars there, your litter numbers start to drop.
So you're saying you need five boars to make sure that those 10 sows will be served?
That's right.
So that's really over the top, again, as far as conventional pig keeping is concerned.
Yeah, and indoors you would take one boar to one sow and
you'd have a supervised service.
You'd have a supervised service.
But not here. These pigs are left to their own devices. And the results are very satisfactory.
Not a bad lot, are they, David?
They're a nice bunch. It's a pity to bring them out in the cold, isn't it? They're obviously nice and warm in there. How many has she got? 3, 4, 5, 6. 10 or 11, ain't she?
One behind me. Yes, 11.
Nice bunch of pigs. Nice bunch of pigs. Do the sows lie on many in these huts? Because you've got no farrowing rails or anything in there, have you?
They lie on a few. I think our mortality's about 10 to as high perhaps as 12%. But and all of them are because of laid on. We don't have scouring problems out here.
But they certainly look nice and comfortable in there, more than you would expect without any artificial heat.
Yes, they're much better off in there than we are out here.
Yeah. What about if you have any farrowing difficulties with the sow, though? How do you deal with that in the middle of a field?
That's difficult to actually do anything with a sow once she's in there. I mean, for a start, I've only had, say, 3 or 4 farrowing problems where I've had to help the piglets out.
Over what sort of period?
Talking about 2.5 years, which is, say, 600 farrowings.
But if you do, you've got no hot water here, no soap here, no electricity.
It's
a bit
cold,
crude.
It's cold water and a lot of soap.
Just over 2 years ago, an outdoor pig herd was established to the west of Fakenham in Norfolk. Bagthorpe Farm runs to 600 acres, and the light land grows cereals, sugar beet and grass seeds, the aftermath of which is ideal for pigs. The 160 sow herd, most of which also have Duroc blood in them, is owned by a new partnership between the landowner and Martin Hannay. It was an opportunity for him to start his own business. But why did he choose outdoor pigs?
Well, I think basically it would have been very difficult for me to make a start in pigs on my own account on an indoor basis due to the enormous capital sums that are involved. But I think also it has to be said that I am probably a good deal happier working in this kind of environment than in an indoor unit.
Now, it was two, three years ago since you started this partnership with Mr. Morton. What do you reckon it did cost you together to put in a unit like this?
Well, basically, at the time, we were talking in terms of about £300 a sow.
Yeah, and what do you reckon you would have spent if you'd done the same numbers of sows on an indoor unit?
I would have thought you would be very lucky to get away with less than 1,000, so we're talking about 30% of the costs involved with intensive pigs.
Yeah, but for that, of course, I presume you would accept a slightly lower performance from the pigs.
Well,
less pigs per sow per year and all that.
Yes, this was the philosophy behind outdoor units some years ago, and certainly it's true to an extent. But the problem, if it is a problem, is that people are able to compete with the indoor units. I mean, there's no reason why we should accept low performance.
Well, what sort of pigs per sow per year records are you keeping here, then?
Last year was 21. We were nudging 21 last year, which is nothing very brilliant, but it looks very much as if we shall be on the verge of 23 this year, and we've still improvements that we know we can make to improve on that.
Figures which compare very favourably indeed with many indoor units. And it's being achieved with very low feeding costs. On alternate days, the Bagthorpe pigs are given fodder beet instead of pig nuts. The sows obviously like them, and the little pigs too. So far, breeding records and growth rates are apparently as good as ever. Which must be satisfying for Donald Morton, the owner of the farm, who admits he knows nothing about pigs, but in spite of that, took on Martin Hannay as partner in the enterprise. So what attracted him to the idea?
We were looking really for a fertility building break crop, non-cereal, and preferably an enterprise that was using cereals.
How do the pigs actually fit in, though, to the arable rotation on the farm?
They fit in after grass seeds and are there for 2 years, and then we follow them with potatoes. And the idea this year is to follow them with organic potatoes. We've had a 2-year break from any pesticides and fertilizers. And we hope that the pigs will be the start of an organic rotation.
So it's given you an entree to yet another business in a way.
Yes, a whole new field has opened up really with the organic side.
Yeah. What about this partnership that you've got with Martin Hannay? How exactly does that work?
Well, Martin provides the expertise for a salary. We provide the land and the buildings, almost on a landlord basis, for a rent and service charge. And then he has his salary from the profits before there's any distribution, and then there's a 50-50 distribution of profits. But obviously with important decisions on how much is to go back into the business to be decided first.
Part of Donald Morton's investment in the pig enterprise is a new general purpose building. It's an ideal cover for the low-cost, unheated bungalows which house the young pigs when they're weaned at 3 to 4 weeks old. Follow-on pens have been put up in the same building to carry the pigs through to 30 kilos when they're sold to a local finisher. But although investment was kept to a minimum, 1987 followed by 1988 was perhaps an unfortunate time to launch a pig business.
I don't think we could have chosen a worse time, really, because first years are always difficult.
Everybody in the pig breeding scene seems to be introducing their own particular type of hybrid outdoor sow. We hear of all sorts of people going in for them. Does it worry you that this particular job is going to be overdone and that'll spoil the prices yet again?
There's a lot of talk about it, but whether there is any real substance behind all the talk, we're not sure. It's not just a straightforward job of there's a field, we'll stuff some pigs on it and hey presto, we're in business. It's not that simple.
It takes a particular kind of person to want to run this kind of outfit.
It takes a lunatic, yes.
Which does tend to put all the excitement over outdoor pigs into perspective. So what are the prospects for more units on the light lands of East Anglia? Or is it all marketing man's hype?
The twin factors which are probably important, breeding companies back in 86 were seeing 1988 coming, not in quite the way that it did, but they were certainly viewing the prospects for new pig units being put up indoors as being something that was difficult to see how it was going to occur in the financial climate within which the pig industry was operating.
Just too expensive.
Too expensive. 15%, I mean, we're paying 15% on money at the moment, and you cannot make the sums make sense for an indoor unit. You can't make the sums make financial sense in a great way for the outdoor units. They're okay, but they're not brilliant. But the indoor unit looks very, very difficult indeed. And we've got to expect that something like 1988 is going to come again. So breeding companies, hopefully seeing forward, which is what they're supposed to do, were predicting that this move would take place. It's not all hype. There's a good deal of truth in it, but of course there's an element of salesmanship always involved.
Ian Campbell of UPB ending that report. And that's it for today. Next weekend, the Festival of Food and Farming is being held in London's Hyde Park, and we'll be there with our cameras for next Sunday's programme. Join us then. Goodbye.
TSB say about a mortgage?
Yes, he said, the way things are, I could get three times my salary.
What about one of those mortgage guarantee certificate things?
Yes, no problem.
But we don't even have a solicitor. What about insurance?
Yes. They can help us with all that.
Then of course we need a loan to make it look really nice.
Yes.
Well, what do you think?
TSB, the bank that likes to say yes.
Shut up!
Morning.
Morning.
Well, no rest for the wicked.
Kellogg's crunchy nut cornflakes are delicious golden flakes of corn encrusted with honey, nuts and brown sugar. Which makes them absolutely irresistible. Kellogg's Crunchy Nut Corn Flakes. The trouble is, they taste too good.
Hey!
This is a kitchen floor, not a racetrack.
Mind you, I need a racing start if I'm to get it clean by 10. Flash liquid.
Ready for your driving lesson, Mrs. Jones.
Flash liquid. Formula One for floors.
Brilliant! Ta-da. You look awful! And dandruff too. Nice touch. What have I said?
But I wash my hair every day, and if I used a dandruff shampoo, I'd end up looking like Kevin.
Well, there's this new Frequent shampoo.
Head and Shoulders?
No, Head and Shoulders Frequent. Try it.
My hair's so soft, it's brightening.
New Head and Shoulders Frequent. A frequent shampoo that clears dandruff, too.
His first time alone at the dentist. My teeth were weak, but his should be stronger.
Is your children's tooth enamel strong enough to fight decay? Imagine their tooth enamel is like a wall. Some areas are more prone to decay. But now a new enamelin formula crest has been developed especially to strengthen tooth enamel against decay.
No fillings.
New enamelin formula crest. A stronger wall against decay.
For the family day out, visit the Bank Holiday Monday Markets at Snetterden Circuit in Norfolk. Children's play area and free parking.
The Anglia News now with Gordon Radley.
Hello, good afternoon. Police are questioning a 15-year-old boy following an accident in which a car ploughed into seven pedestrians at Southend last night. One was seriously hurt when the car crashed into them in Green Lane. It's thought the pedestrians, all teenagers, recognised the driver and signalled him to stop. 39 people have been arrested since the start of the big bank holiday scooter rally at Great Yarmouth. Special courts have been sitting and fines of up to £200 have been imposed for the majority of offences under the Public Order Act. However, police say most youngsters attending the rally have been well behaved and few complaints have been received from the public. Lindsay Brooke reports.
Over 8,000 have arrived in Great Yarmouth for the biggest scooter event of the year. They've travelled from as far afield as Scotland and the Channel Islands. So far, there have been no serious problems in the town. Although 39 arrests were made overnight, half on public order offences, police say the large majority are well behaved. Other offences include theft, burglary, criminal damage and possession of drugs. These are being dealt with in special court sitting over the weekend. Meanwhile, 183 fixed penalty tickets have been issued for driving offences. Police have received 15 complaints from the public, the majority from licensees calling for assistance. Most of the problems have been drink-related, and all seafront pubs will be closed this afternoon to give publicans a well-earned break.
More than 800 runners set off this morning in one of the region's biggest fundraising events, the Norfolk Marathon. Among this year's competitors is the Lord Mayor of Norwich, who's covering the 13-mile half-marathon course in his wheelchair, pushed by the city sheriff. They hope to raise £300 for Kelling Hospital. The winner of the full marathon from Holt to Norwich is expected to finish in just over half an hour's time. Finally, dog owners in Cambridgeshire believe they found the answer to water safety. They're spearheading a campaign to have their special pets trained as lifeguards to patrol holiday resorts and water sports centres. This weekend, a team of French handlers have been demonstrating how Newfoundland dogs can be trained to carry out rescue work. This weekend, a special course is being held at Meeple to demonstrate the potential skills of the world's strongest dog. Its strong swimming ability was first spotted by Newfoundland fishermen who trained the dogs to carry nets from one boat to another. During one exercise, a fisherman fell overboard and was rescued by the animal. In France, the dogs are frequently used on water patrols and rescue work. That's the news for the time being. Back with you at 6:35. Look forward to your company.
You're watching Anglia, and the time now is 1 o'clock.
Hairspray with firmer hold and gentle conditioning. If it's your style, hold on to it.
Tefal's new DuraGlide iron is going to make life easier for everyone. Not only does it use ordinary tap water and have this double steam trigger for really stubborn creases, it also has this unique DuraGlide base. Because it's so much smoother than other irons, ironing takes less time and effort, and even the most difficult fabrics are a pushover. Good news, eh? Especially for me.
The new Tefal DuraGlide, a smoother iron for easier ironing.
Walter, which tie are you going to wear?
Can I help you?
So you're about to buy a flat. What sort of mortgage are you interested in? Let me explain your options.
At NatWest, we know what choosing a mortgage feels like. But don't worry. If a simple endowment or repayment isn't suitable for you, we'll design a mortgage that is. With our help, anyone can make the right decision.
Well, that's my mortgage sorted.
Well done, Walter. Now, do you want tea or coffee?
I'll have a...
NatWest take the... out of choosing a mortgage.
Triangle?
What's it worth?
Swap your name!
Kids will give anything for Dairy Lee.
Imagine a shampoo this pure, this gentle. Timotei shampoo with natural herb extracts. Timotei rinses clean away to leave your hair soft and shiny, no matter how many times you use it. Timotei, all it leaves is beautiful hair.
A grand, cosy feeling, huh?
Hamish! Hamish Rugglamis, wait for me!
Did you hear that, Dinkus? Did you hear that, huh? No, none of that, you naughty boy. None of that, I say.